Welcome, Team Fairchild. I'm Second Lieutenant Hillary Klom. Today I will be briefing you on TRICARE, how it relates to you when you have a permanent change of station. So this is what we'll be talking about today. What is TRICARE? How do you plan on your move? Getting care with while you're traveling, and your benefit at your new location, and other important information. We'll go over a checklist and then some information for you to call in case you need any assistance. So TRICARE is separated into two different regions. Fairchild is in the west region, and if you were to travel anywhere outside of the west region, you will be dealing with Humana Health rather than Health Net Federal Services here in Washington State. And then there's also an overseas program if you are PCSing overseas. There's the Latin America and Canada phone number and POC over there that we'll have at the end slide, the Eurasia and Africa, and then the Pacific. So the overseas program is, again, also separate contractor within TRICARE, and that will be SOS International will be your TRICARE program. And then planning for your move. Active duty service members must be enrolled in the prime. Your dependents do have an option to enroll in to select with a monthly premium fee. So don't disenroll from TRICARE Prime or other services. Keep what you're enrolled in, but just give HealthNet a phone call before you leave. And then when you arrive to your location, go ahead and call them again. To let them know of your new destination. That's when you can call and say, okay, I am now at this base and I am assigned to this unit, and then you'll be correctly assigned to the new provider. Also make sure that you contact DEAR's office and update your address and make sure all your information is correct, as well go into Mill Connect and do the same. And then you'll learn more about your TRICARE options at your new location. And the TRICARE website is always a good resource if you have any questions. It's very easy to understand as well if you have any questions. So before moving, make sure that you press your medical and dental records. You can come in to the clinic and request that. We'll fill out a form and we can mail it to you, or you can come pick it up. The wait time is usually 2 weeks, and it can take up to 30 days. Refill or fill your prescriptions, and then also plan for transferring that prescription. You should also look into e-scripts as a very convenient way to get your medications, especially with the current situation with COVID. It's very convenient to get the prescriptions mailed to you. And then just plan ahead of time if you need any routine medical care. To make sure that you're up to date on your IMR, so your dental appointments, any immunizations, various things like that, to maintain medical readiness. And then also make sure that if you're an EFMP member, make sure that you coordinate with our special needs coordinator for any care, and make sure that you can safely PCS to your new location and there is the medical care at the level that you need. And then getting care during your move. Again, if you have any emergency, you can call the emergency room, 911, or head there without a referral. If you have something urgent that you need care for, just go ahead and call the nurse advice line at 1-800-TRICARE, and they can get the active duty member a referral for urgent care to go to an urgent care center. Dependents can go to urgent care centers without a referral. And then for any prescriptions, you can visit that website or call that phone number for more information. Okay, and these are the resources, like I mentioned earlier, to update your information in DEARS, to go to Mill Connect and do the same. And then those are the phone numbers you can call for DEARS as well. So there's many ways. And the TRICARE Prime enrollment. Updating DEARS does not mean that you called TRICARE and updated your enrollment or got a PCM at all. It is totally a separate tasks to do, so please do both and call DEERS and TRICARE to make sure that they have the correct information and that you can be seen at the clinic where you're going, or if you're in TRICARE Prime Remote, that you can be seen in the civilian network. This is a little bit more information about TRICARE Prime. It's available for you to access the military hospital or clinic, any established TRICARE networks, and there is some information on the U.S. Family Health Plan. That's offered. You can get more information online, but it is usually a very expensive option, so Prime and Select are majority of how TRICARE is used. And then, like I mentioned earlier, this health plan is very expensive. It can cost thousands of dollars per month. And so it is something that allows you to get care outside of the network, but it's also only available at certain regions of the United States. As you can see, more of the New England states, the west side of Washington State, and southeast of Texas. And then the overseas program, there will be some contact information and information on the website. If you have more specific questions, you can always call them. It is definitely a separate process when you're overseas. Your active duty dental benefits, you don't need to enroll in that. That's automatic. However, if you buy the active duty dental program for your family, just make sure that you find a dentist in the local area and you understand what your benefits are for the active duty dental program. And that's more just contact information, so don't disenroll in it. Just update your address when you arrive to your location, and then you can find dentists on that website right there or call. These are your pharmacy options to get it, your prescriptions for free. You can head to the military pharmacy. You can do home delivery. There's a small copay, I think around $7. And the network pharmacy, you can find like a local Walmart or Walgreens pharmacy that's in network, or you can go to your network pharmacy of choice, but that will be a higher full cost that you will have to pay for. And then that's just one of the Affordable Care Act. TRICARE is the necessary medical coverage that you need. This is your checklist. Again, don't disenroll from TRICARE Prime. Just contact TRICARE prior to leaving and then contact them again to get registered at your new location. Call DEERS to update your information. Make sure you fill in your prescriptions and have a plan for getting your prescriptions once you arrive. Get copies of your medical and dental records within the clinic, and then make sure that you have a current phone number for your PCM, and coordinate any special care needs that you need. So these are the steps for your move. And then on the road, if you have any need for urgent or routine care, you won't need a referral if you're a dependent. It's always important to verify with a nurse advice line if you need to be seen. But again, for the emergency, just head straight to the emergency room. And then at your new location, again, call DEERS, call TRICARE, and get enrolled. And then this is the information that I mentioned earlier for the East and West region. The West region here in Fairchild is HealthNet Federal Services, and then the East is Humana, and then there's also the overseas number for you. And that ends my briefing. If you have any questions, feel free to call us at 509-247-2405. That is the phone number to medical records if you need any assistance. Again, 509-247-2405. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Jack Farber from the Fairchild Air Force Base Housing Office, and we're going to give you a little briefing on what the housing office can do for you. Next slide. If you're leaving from being on base, Provide written notice at least 20 days in advance. Schedule the move out and inspection dates. Complete your move out checklist and cleaning. Move out, complete final inspection, complete change of address with the post office at least 1 week, but no more than 30 days prior to your move. Complete advanced housing application if on-base housing is desired at your next base. Next. If you're leaving the dorm, provide written notice at least 20 days in advance to the dormitory maintenance, the dormitory staff, pardon me. Call in maintenance for necessary repairs, pack and clean, sign out with the dormitory managers, complete change of address with the post office at least 1 week, but no more than 30 days prior to the move. Understand your new housing requirements in BAH. Next, please. If you're leaving off-base housing, provide written notice at least 20 days in advance to your landlord. Complete necessary checklist cleaning according to your lease requirements. Provide a forwarding address to the landlord. Plan on 21 days for deposit if available. complete change of address with the post office at least 1 week, but no more than 30 days prior to your move. Next, please. When you arrive at your new base, let's say your new base is in the continental United States, check in with housing and complete an application for off-base housing, for on-base housing, pardon me. Update the zip code with your with finance if you're living off-base. Keep good records and expense receipts during your PCS. BAH is meant to cover rent and utilities with 5% out of pocket. Next, please. These are just 2020 BAH rates and how they go for a company. Next. And the same for unaccompanied. Next. Okay. Arrival at your new base, if you're going overseas, go to housing first. I can't stress that enough. It's one of the first things you need to do. COLA and OHA are very different than BAH. You must see the housing office before any lease agreement is gotten into. Next. There's also the Service Members Civil Relief Act. It's a federal law that provides protection for active duty military and activated guard and reserve on orders longer than 30 days and sick or wounded members. Benefits include a 6% rate cap on obligations incurred prior to military, ability to stay, civil proceedings, protections with lease terminations, foreclosures, and installment contracts, car loans, furniture, etc. Next. That's it. Thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Lonnie. I work with the Privatized Housing here at Fairchild Air Force Base, which is Balfour Beatty Communities. And I'm going to do your out briefing. So we are Fairchild AFB Homes, and our hours are Monday through Friday. We are 8 to 5, and our phone number is 509-244-6500. Anytime you guys have any questions, please do give us a call. We would be glad to help you. So we do also do the applications for you. Not all bases are privatized. So if you're PCSing from a privatized base, you will need their specific application. If you're PCSing between Balfour Beatty community bases, and you're going to move from Balfour Beatty base to another Balfour Beatty base, you can receive $250 off the first month's rent, which is the Coast to Coast program. Use good information, emails, phone numbers are good, and make sure you do have voicemail, because that seems to be another issue that people don't set up their voicemail. Base housing, Washington state law, you do have to give us at least 20 days written notice or more. So as soon as you know you're going to be leaving, you're welcome to give us the 20 days notice prior to vacating. This form can be emailed to you. There will be a move-out guide. We'll provide that for you. We'll do a pre-inspection, which is going to be an inspection that will come to your house. And we'll go over cleaning standards and answer any questions that you have, because we'll be actually at your house to prep you for your final. Final inspection, everything must be removed from your home. Prior to inspection, the house must be clean, and if you're going to do an express clean, we will need to have that receipt at the final inspection. Self-cleans, you guys are welcome to clean the house yourself. You just have to follow the move-out guide, and Express Clean, we will schedule the cleaner for you. Paid receipt will be provided to you on the move out, and we'll take that from you. Cleaner will be scheduled after we do the final with you at the home. All carpets must be vacuumed, so make sure you vacuum your carpet north, south, east, and west, and then stay off your carpet. Pets, please do refer to the pet addendum prior to obtaining new pets, and please do not leave your pets behind when you move out. Your mail, make sure you forward your mail prior to moving, and we'll also remind you that on your final, because there's lots of stuff that you go through on your final. And if you have any questions at all, please make sure you call the 509-244-6500, and we'll be glad to help you with anything you need.
Hey guys, so I recently PCS'd and I'm having to take care of a bunch of stuff, like checking out my new digs and sending my family my new address, because y'all know I want those care packages. I also met with a bunch of the people in my unit and they're pretty chill. One of them actually told me about a bunch of forms I need to fill out to vote absentee in the next election. As you all may know, if you're active duty and stationed away from home, you can still vote. So I sat down with my voting assistance officer here and got a bunch of info. Most units have one. But if you do have one, well then consider them your POC for this kind of stuff. If you don't have one, well then today's your lucky day, cause I'm here. The process seemed kind of confusing at first, but I've got the steps down now, so I figured I'd go through the process with y'all. All right, I got this form from my voting assistance officer. It's called the Federal Postcard Application. Probably just easier to remember FPCA, but whatever floats your boat. It lets you register to vote and request an absentee ballot from your home state. Then your state will send you a ballot wherever you're stationed. The VAO told me to do a new one every year or when I either move or deploy. He also told me to do one 3 months before an election just to make sure everything's good to go. I also know you can find and fill out this form on the website for the Federal Voting Assistance Program. That's fvap.gov. I'm just gonna leave that right there in case you forget everything I'm about to say, because you can just go to fvap.gov and figure it out from there. But my VA already gave me this form, and it's got this built-in handy envelope with postage paid. All right, so it starts with the straightforward ID stuff, classification, name. All right, y'all don't need to sit through this stuff. All right, that was pretty easy. The only parts I needed to check on were voting residence and current address. The back of the form asked me to check out my state guidelines, which I found on fvap.gov. So it's gonna ask you for two addresses. The first one is gonna be your last address in your state of legal residence, even if you don't live there anymore. The second one is gonna be your current mailing address, and then they'll send your ballot to that address. All right, I'm done filling this thing out and I'm about to send it off. I could send this thing by email to the election office, but I don't have a scanner. So I'm just gonna sign it and send it in using this postage paid envelope. Just check and see what your state allows on the website and make sure you sign before you send. Also, even if you don't email the form, you should include your email address just in case the election office needs to get in contact with you in case you're missing anything. So yeah. All in all, that only took me about, what, 10 minutes? Now all I have to do is wait for my absentee ballot. Just kidding. I'll be back when my ballot arrives before the election. Hey guys, back at it again. Do I look older? Well, I'm squared away with my new unit, and my absentee ballot just arrived. It's a little more than a month before the election, and I need to send this back in ASAP. Y'all ready? I'm about to walk through filling out this ballot and sending it in, AKA voting. All right, I looked it up and my state requires that I send this in by mail. I know some states allow you to send this in by email, so look that up. But mail is always an option.
Looks like it came with all the instructions. Fill it out, sign it, seal and send in security envelope, and mail it back.
Okay. I guess my job is done. Well, it wasn't even long enough for a new post.
Just kidding, you're not through with me yet. So I mailed in my ballot a while ago, no problem, but I heard from somebody in my unit that the process was less than straightforward for her.
Hey guys. Yeah, so I filled out and sent in my FPCA just like you did, but I'm still waiting for my absentee ballot. I'm starting to get a bit worried because we're less than a month out from the election and I want to make sure I can vote.
Well, the good news is there's a plan B. We looked it up at fvap.gov. It's called the Federal Write-In Absentee Ballot, or FWAB. Basically, it's just a backup ballot in case your regular ballot doesn't arrive in time. The good news is that the election office will only count one ballot.
So if you're like me and don't know whether your state ballot will arrive on time, you can fill this one out and send it in.
Oh, one last piece of advice. If you have to fill out the FWAB, try and do it online. You guessed it, fvap.gov.
It even has step-by-step instructions and a list of all the federal candidates you can vote on.
All you have to do is print it, sign it, and send it back to your election office ASAP. So I'm done. I voted. Now I know what you're thinking. How do you know your vote was actually received? I sent it off. What then? Well, what do you know? You can do that at fvap.gov too. Just click your state and check the status of your voted ballot. Doing that right now, actually. Want to make sure my vote's getting received. Yep, nice. Wow, well that wasn't so bad. If you want to know more, just go to fvap.gov or check in with your voting assistance officer. Or you can even like FVAP on Facebook for tips and reminders.
Good morning and welcome to Fairchild Air Force Base. My name is Steve McMullen. I am the school liaison assigned to Fairchild. So one of my roles is to help transitioning military families choose schools and to help them understand what they need to do to get enrolled in school, as well as handle any kind of issues that families may have with districts or with particular schools or anything like that. Here in Washington State, we have what's called free educational choice. That means that no matter what district your home district is, you can actually choose a different district to educate your children. There are some caveats to that that I can explain to people on an individual basis, but generally you can choose any one of 11 districts in this area to educate your children. Now during this time, Washington State schools, including private schools, are all shut down. We have no idea if and when they're going to open up in the fall. Actually, that is going to be Governor Inslee's decision to make. Right now, we are out of school on June 17th for our home district of Medical Lake, Washington. And we will be monitoring all of the happenings in the districts. Generally, right now, all the districts are planning on opening up in the fall, but we really don't know how that's going to happen or anything like that. So, best thing is to get a hold of me. I can be reached at 509-247-2559. That actually goes directly to my home phone. Or you can email me at steven.mcmullen@us.af.mil. I am up and operational from home and in the office occasionally, so feel free to reach out with any kind of questions that you have regarding school districts, regarding what types of things school districts are offering for virtual learning, and possibly when school districts are going to be back in session. Thank you very much. Once again, welcome to Fairchild Air Force Base. Have a great day.
Hello, how you doing today? My name is Robert Griffin. I'm the Personal Finance Manager here at AFRC at Fairchild. This is going to be a quick finance briefing for Smooth Move. As you're going out, some things to think about. Different things on moving costs. You'll get the briefings from TMO. You all know the different allowances, etc. Some things to keep in mind. There's hidden costs in PCSs that aren't always covered or thought about. Pets. Where, you know, you have pets. You got a place to kennel them, finding hotels that are pet friendly and they'll trip. Kids, make sure they have the certain things they need as they're going. Maybe favorite toys for the younger ones, etc. Movies. And then when you're leaving, both leaving and at the new place, you're going to be cleaning your government quarters, your rentals, houses to be sold, so there's extra cleaning supplies above the norm. Same thing when you get to the new place, most folks will clean that up as well, so there's perishables, restocking, etc. Taxes, people kind of forget that. With your spouses, military spouses, if they have a job and they're going, transferring, that's a big hit on the income for a while. And then taxes as well. Different states have taxes. There are some provisions now with military spouses that you can keep your state of residence. However, with military, if you happen to be PCS and back to the state of your residence, you'd have to check with them, because while you're out of the state, you might not have been paying their state taxes. Some states, while you're active duty military and you are actually back in their state, they will have you pay those taxes. So that's something you want to look at. If you have questions on that, please come see me, or Miss Adrienne Ross is our personal finance counselor. She's a certified financial planner. She knows all the ins and outs of all of this tax. Can get you up to speed on that and help you find out all the right information for that. Each state has their own rules for active duty and spaces and spouses, so depending on where you're going. If you're leaving Fairchild and you're going to, say, Alaska or Hawaii, where cost of living is higher, income's going to come up. Wardrobes might change a little bit, especially if you're going from here to Hawaii. They don't have snow, so you're going to have some extra cost of clothes there too. Cost of living changes are drastic sometimes, depending on your housing costs, etc. Before you go, don't forget to change your address with creditors, financial institutions. Get a forwarding address to your post office so you still get those important things. You can update your address with the IRS using the form 8822. TSP, make sure you keep that up to date once you get to the other end. If you have any changes in insurances, cars, life insurance, etc., those are all things to think of, a smooth move. Now, currently, we're in this whole COVID-19 crisis that has changed a lot. A lot of people's budgets have drastically changed. That means we're at the stay-at-home order. We're staying home, right? So we probably have a little extra money that we haven't had before, because we're not eating out, we're not going to movies, we're not going shopping on a lot of this stuff. Our food budgets have probably drastically gone up. But this is a good time, if ever, as financial advisors, we're always talking about having an emergency fund. Well, I can think of no better time to maybe wish you'd had an emergency fund than during this COVID-19, especially for some of our civilians or people that were laid off, furloughed, in some cases lost their jobs altogether. We're always preaching that emergency fund, so it's something to think about. Some of this extra money you get in the stimulus checks. Maybe you want to boost cash reserves. Maybe you look for emergency savings. Expect the unexpected expenses. Assume something's going to happen. What could you do with it? Pay down some debt? Can you completely erase a debt or reduce it? Look at your debts. Is it a high interest rate? Is there a lower one? Or is it near the term, or are you just getting started on that? The point is, come talk to me or Adrienne. We can help you decide what's the best way with a power pay plan, snowball effect. It's a good chance to get yourself, if you have some debt you've been trying to get rid of, we can help plan to get that out of there while you're getting this extra money that's available. It's a strategic approach. Maybe you need something fixing, something you've been kind of putting off. Now you have some money, maybe to maintenance. It's a good time to think about that. Cash savings is one thing. Reducing and eliminating debt is another option. What else can you eliminate? Addressing your expenses. Eating out, obviously, is ground to a halt, like I said. How can you use that money? Gas prices are cheaper than they've been in years, obviously, so even going anywhere is a lot cheaper than it used to be. How much are you saving in gas? Maybe that could be used somewhere. Currently still, hair salons, nails, barbershops are all closed. For some folks, that can be a big area. What other areas of the budget could you look at to adjust? How much cash savings is enough? That's the answer everybody's going to ask. It depends on your circumstances. Think about things to include. If you're close to retirement, get ready to transition, then we obviously say we want you to have 3 to 6 months of reserve. However, nowhere now there's even more uncertainty with job opportunities and the cost of living. So you want to look at that. Maybe you want to get 6 to 12 months reserved if you have that kind of time before you get out. Depends on you, what you're at, where you're at, and you're comfortable, how much debt you have, and what kind. Cash savings buys you time to make those decisions. Find some resources, take some actions, and rather than reacting to the ups and downs as they come, be prepared for them. It's a whole lot easier to weather something like this when you can still pay the bills regardless if money's not coming in at the time. And if you have that 3 to 6 months of living expenses, most emergencies, be it COVID-19, be it earthquakes, typhoons, we all have seen the natural disasters over the years in the different parts of the country. That helps weather the storms until you can get back on normal and still not come out on the other end of whatever that disaster is and be behind. So again, wish you a good move for where you're going. Call us, talk to Adrian or myself. We're still available by phone, even though we're closed. You can contact us. The slides will be up with our contact numbers, and we can help address any of the financial questions or plans you have. Have a safe trip.
Hi, everybody. My name is Debbie Medlin, and I'm with WorkSource Spokane. I'm here to offer some assistance, hopefully, on your transition out of the military. My primary job is to help with resume prep and job search, and also talk about the economic environment in the local communities that you might be going to. So these are all three really important things that we need to start considering prior to you leaving the military. Number one, let's talk about resume prep. There are a couple different types of resumes out there. There's the federal resume, there will be the, and then your civilian resume, you can have the traditional chronological or a functional resume. Know that's a lot to take in, but that's my job. I'm here to help you. If you are in need of resume assistance, you can reach out to me at 509-590-5564 or email me at dmedlen, M-E-D-L-E-N, dot E-S-D, Employment Security Department, dot W-A, dot G-O-V. And we'll also post this on the Facebook page so you have that available. But I am here to help. I know this is probably a pretty scary time thinking about transitioning out of the military. Now everybody's unemployed. What's that going to look like for you? I want to let you know that this is a time for you to become a marketing person and utilize your military experience as your marketing tool. We are seeing businesses that have been unable to overcome some of the obstacles with this pandemic. They weren't prepared for it. They have had to downsize in their workforce, and now they're scrambling to keep that workforce together and kind of piecemeal things together. You guys are experts in that. So I just want to reassure you that if you market this properly, if you market yourself properly.
Hello, my name is Senior Airman Allen from Fairchild Air Force Base Finance. Today we'll be going over permanent change of station scenarios and entitlements. Thanks. PCSs can vary from person to person. Not every travel will be the same, but moving your entire life from one place to another can be extremely taxing on a person mentally, physically, and financially. These slides are meant to cover the more common entitlements that you may come across while traveling. Next. Today, we'll be going over the following topics before departing for your PCS, what to bring along, and lastly, your entitlements. Before departing your current duty station, we advise you to obtain a copy of your LES, which is available from MyPay. This will help you plan accordingly and give you a good idea of what entitlements you are currently receiving. Turn your orders into finance and let them know when you are projected to arrive at your next base 30 days prior to your departure. If you do not have a government travel card, which is mandated for your travel usage, you should get with your unit agency program coordinator prior to leaving to request one. Also ensure your unit APC places your GTC in a mission critical status prior to leaving. You may need or want to pay in advance for any PCS related expenses not covered in any other advance, such as car repairs, furniture, appliances, or a car if you're PCSing to a location you cannot ship your POV. Advances can be obtained by completing a DD Form 2560 available on the DOD Forms website, and submitting the completed form with your orders to finance no earlier than 30 days prior to your departure. Next. While traveling, you will need money to move. The government travel charge card, or GTC, should be your primary source of payment for official travel-related expenses. If you are not able to swipe your GTC at a certain locations for official travel, up to $250 may be withdrawn from the ATM, but keep in mind that ATM fees are not reimbursable. It is wise to also hand carry all important items such as ID cards, birth certificates, marriage certificates, and all paperwork from TMO, and more importantly, copy of your orders. Next. Permissive house hunting is not a payable expense. It is 10 days that the commander can approve to look for a house as permissive leave, a non-chargeable type of leave. House hunting is input by the member or their CSS, and is approved by the squadron commander. Finance is not involved with permissive house hunting. However, house hunting is not a reason to delay a voucher or other financial responsibilities within the prescribed 5 days after arrival per AFI. Next. Advanced military pay may be requested 30 days prior to the move or 60 days after you arrive to your next duty station. If you are E3 or below, you must have a DD-2560 signed by your commander to do so. If you are E4 and above, you can receive up to 1 month of base pay. A DD-2560 signed by your commander must be completed for anything beyond that. If you are PCSing overseas, or to a stateside location that authorizes COLA, it is not started until you file your voucher with your next duty station. However, it will begin the day of your arrival. Temporary lodging, or TLA, is determined by the housing office overseas. You must complete this through them, and it can be authorized up to 60 days, but the housing office is the final determining factor on the authorized dates. Next. Temporary lodging, or TLE, is from stateside to stateside or stateside to overseas only. It is payable up to 10 days split between your old base and new base, paid at the local per diem rate. For instance, if you took 8 days of TLE after your household goods were shipped at your old base, this would mean you have a remaining balance of 2 days of TLE at the new base. If you stayed in lodging 8 days at the old base and 10 days at the new base, you would only get 8 days of TLE for the old base and 2 days for the new base, totaling 10 days. Or you could claim all 10 days at the new duty station. The choice of what you claim is yours, but only for a total of 10 payable days. If you are traveling from stateside to overseas, the TLE would reduce to a maximum of 5 days, must be at your losing duty station. Overseas to stateside is 10 days, all at the gaining station. Next. When driving from one base to the next, official travel days are calculated as 1 day is authorized for each 350 miles of official distance. Despite what may be written on your orders, the official travel distance may be different because it does not account for variations to travel. The Defense Table of Official Distances, or DTOD, found in the DTMO website is where official travel distances may be found. Mileage for the official distance that was driven is paid at 17 cents per mile for per car, max of 2 cars authorized. If you came by yourself and drove 1 car, 2 cars if you and your dependent or dependents drove any additional car. No, a single member cannot have or be paid for 2 cars. Next. The standard rate per official travel day is $150 per day. Spouses and dependents 12 or older receive 75% or $113.25. And dependents under 12 receive 50% or $75.50. Next. If you are flying to the next duty station, you may only be reimbursed up to what the government cost is by booking through the government travel agency. If you book through the government, you may receive the entire cost back provided leave travel was not purchased. If the airfare was booked through anything but the government, then you will only receive up to what is the YCA rate and the GSA website, citypairs.com produces. Government tickets may be purchased through TMO, must be purchased for all overseas travel. Per diem will be paid based off where you are lodged overnight, if you have a mandatory delay, or if you're coming from overseas. Otherwise, per diem is based off of your new duty location. Next. Members who are traveling overseas and authorized to ship a POV may be authorized 54 cents per round trip to the vehicle processing center, if not done in conjunction with your PCS. If you drop your car at the VPC in conjunction with your PCS, you're entitled to the PCS mileage rate and PCS per diem. In order to claim the mileage for this, the DD Form 788 or a form with the car on it from the VPC must be submitted with the travel voucher. Next. Dislocation allowance or DLA is an entitlement that partially reimburses a member for expenses when they relocate from one household to another household. If you do not have a household or are not moving to one, then you will not be able to claim DLA. For example, if you are to move to the dorms at your next duty station, you are not entitled to DLA. DLA is based on a with or without dependent rate. If your dependents do not relocate, you are only entitled to the without dependent rate. If you are advanced the with dependent rate, you will have a debt if your dependents do not relocate. The most current rates are found on the DTMO website on the link attached. Next. Here's an example of what the DLA table looks like. Next. What we do before departing PCS, you turn your orders into finance and keep your LES handy. What to bring for your travel, orders and other important documents, and utilizing your GTC as mandated per the GTCC regulations, and your military pay entitlements such as mileage per diem, DLA, and DLA. If you have any questions, again, my name is Senior Airman Allen from the Fairchild Finance Office. Our customer service hours are from 0730 to 1530, and phone line is 509-247-9462 for travel, 509-247-3748 for military pay issues. Please let us know if you have any additional questions so we can assure you have a smooth move.
Hi Team Fairchild, I'm Captain Pico. I'm the officer in charge of the veterinary treatment facility on base here. We do serve working dogs and we also take care of our service members' pets. So reserve, retired, active duty, we're here to help take care of your pets. We offer a variety of services here, mostly wellness and sick exams. We can do in-house lab work, x-rays. We also send out a number of labs to both civilian and DOD lab diagnostic laboratories. We do microchips, of course, and vaccinations, and then health certificates are a big piece of what we do as well. More on that to come. We do surgeries and dental cleanings as well, mostly routine spays, neuters, mass removals. We're able to do some more complicated, and we're able to do, you know, dental x-rays, extractions, limited root canal capabilities that we coordinate on. And then our waiting list, unfortunately, on the surgeries and dental cleanings is currently closed between COVID and the fact that the list was getting too long. As soon as we're able to do procedures once again, though, we absolutely will be working to reopen that list in the future and fill this need. With the health certificates, anytime an animal crosses the state lines, they do need a health certificate by law. The purpose of this is to make sure that the animal does not have any contagious diseases that they are going to spread to other animals as they travel. So for our pets, state to state, usually only rabies, but states do vary a little bit on what they require. This can be done by a military or a civilian veterinarian, and it's pretty routine. The international health certificates do get a lot more complicated. Every country has different requirements. Sometimes it requires multiple visits to do vaccinations, blood tests, and then quarantines as well. We want to make sure that we get on top of these as soon as possible because we don't want your pet getting stuck in quarantine once you arrive at your in country. These health certificates need to be signed by a military veterinarian. If you have it done by a civilian veterinarian, you have to have an extra step where it's endorsed by the USDA. So this is additional time and money, and this is a complicated process that a lot of civilian veterinarians are not used to. Since we do this pretty routinely, we're able to try and get you guys in and out as quickly as possible with as least expense as possible as well. The website on the bottom here is just a site that the USDA has developed. They have common requirements depending on which country you're going to, and it'll help step you through the process. We're here to help as well with this. This can get updated pretty, this site is updated pretty regularly, but requirements can change pretty rapidly as different events occur across countries. So trying to stay up to date is critical whenever you're going overseas. Our location and contact information is up here. We are catty corner to the fitness center and the school on base. We're right next to the military working dogs for to make sure we take care of them. But we're pretty convenient and locally located. With COVID-19, we are scaled down pretty dramatically, unfortunately, at this point that we're at HPCon Charlie. We are still filling out pet medications, and so absolutely give us a call and we'll be make sure that we get that to you. We do have some limited curbside appointments for primarily health certificates. We are working to start implementing some telehealth options as well. Unfortunately, those are going to be fairly limited though in what we're able to provide. But absolutely give us a call. We'll help you work through whatever the problem is. And if we're not able to serve that need, we can absolutely refer you to some clinics off base as well. Any other questions, you're absolutely welcome to give us a call.
Hi, my name is Christina. I'm with the traffic management flight, the TMO office, or the traffic management office. We have many names, but we do the same thing. So, on this slide, I have our address, our location, our hours of operation, and our telephone numbers. I recommend that as soon as you get notified of an assignment, that you contact us or stop by. At this time, please call before you stop by to make sure that we're taking customers. Next slide. Okay, as I said, you're lucky. You've got an assignment. You're going someplace else. As soon as you receive your assignment notification, if you're going overseas, we would like that you give us a call. As soon as you receive your assignment orders, we ask that you stop by the transportation office and get scheduled for your House of Goods briefing immediately. The reason being is there is a delay from the time we can get you briefed to the time we can get your House of Goods picked up. Transportation office normally requires a 21-day lead time. That lead time changes during our peak season, which is May through August. So please notify us or contact us as soon as you get your orders so that we can assist you and get your House of Goods picked up in a timely manner. Next slide. Okay, what are your entitlements? If you're going stateside, you're entitled to a shipment of personal property from point A to point B. You are also entitled to a self-procured move, which means that you're either going to get a rental truck and move everything yourself, or you're going to put property in your car and drive it from point A to point B. That is more than welcome. If you're going OCONUS, it's a little difficult to do that self-procured move. However, you are entitled to a house or good shipment. You can be entitled to an unaccompanied baggage shipment. You can be entitled to a non-temporary storage shipment, which is stuff that you can't take to that overseas location, but the government's not gonna say, hey, sell it. You can also do a POV shipment, and you can do a mail reimbursement. That's that self-procured move. You can mail some stuff to you that you would like and that possibly get reimbursed or compensated for that amount. Next slide. Okay, there are two ways that you can do this. We would love it if you would log on to the Defense Personal Property System via the move.mil website and self-counsel yourself. That is perfectly authorized to do. It's just going to be step-by-step instructions on how to self-counsel your housing and shipment, your unaccompanied baggage shipment, whatever it is that you want to do. Or you can come into our the transportation office and request a briefing, and we'll brief you in person the exact same thing that you would read on the DPS website. So please, if you would like to self-counsel, please do so. If you don't want to, like I said, call the transportation office, make sure we're taking clients, and then we'll walk you through the appointments process, get you briefed, get your paperwork finalized, and get your move scheduled. Next slide. Okay, for those of you that are flying overseas, you're going to need to contact us to arrange what we call your port call. We have a form, it's the Air Force Form 1546. Here at Fairchild, we actually have a modified version of that. So it's the Fairchild Air Force Base Form 1546 port call request. This is a required document for any individual that is going overseas or to Alaska and Hawaii, because those are considered overseas assignments. As soon as you are notified of your upcoming assignments to an overseas location, we would love it if you would contact the transportation office. The reason being, we use this form to book your flights for you to go overseas with you or your family. If we don't have those forms in a timely manner, we may miss out on the opportunity to book you on a government flight, and you may end up having to pay for commercial airline tickets. So please give us a call. Next slide. The other reason why this form is so important, those of you that are traveling with a pet, there are limited pet spots on military flights on the Rotators Patriot Express. The sooner we get that form, the better off you are positioned to travel on a military flight with your Fluffy the cat or Scruffy the dog. So please get us that form immediately, because as soon as those flights open up, we can book your flight. If you wait until the month prior to your departure or 2 months prior, those coveted, hard to come by pet spots on military flights are all gone. And you may not be able to afford to send your animal commercial to your overseas location. So please contact us. I cannot stress, please contact us as soon as you know of your upcoming overseas assignment. You do not need orders to turn in this form. Please contact us. Next slide. Okay. Again, if you are traveling overseas, you are more than welcome to give us a call. We'll provide you information on your personal property, house of goods, unaccompanied baggage, storage for long-term in the local area. Talk about your PUV, whether or not you're authorized to ship it, whether or not you're authorized to store it. And then we'll talk to you about how you're gonna get from point A to point B with either commercial travel or through a government flight. It's gonna be a combination thereof, because from Fairchild, you have to fly commercially to Seattle to get on a flight, or you'll have to fly from Spokane to Baltimore to get on a military flight. So please, give us a call. Don't wait, please.
Hello, I'm Staff Sergeant Kalia Foreman from the Fairchild Air Force Base Legal Office. I work in the General Law, Civil Law section, and I'm here to talk to you today about your smooth move in the Air Force Claim Service Center. They're located at Wright-Patt Air Force Base. If you've ever had the chance to talk to them, there's actual humans there. There's no robots, no machine that you're talking to and pressing buttons for. They're actually a nice group of people, and this is ultimately their job and what they do all day long. High value items. Make sure you make a list. One problem we ran into was members PCSing, and they did a power of attorney for their spouse to take care of items while they were gone. TDY or something in the process of them moving. The spouse wrote down that there were 7 weapons when really there were 8. By the time they got here, they spoke to us about the fact that they didn't have the 8th weapon. It wasn't on their listing, and there was nothing that the moving companies could say or help them with. Make sure you are going detail for detail with items that you have. Jewelry. Jewelry is a high one as well. I know it's a lot. Maybe you have 47 necklaces and you don't feel like going into detail about each one because you've had a long day. But when you show up with 40 necklaces and you're missing 7 of your most expensive, you're going to wish you had done it. DVDs, things like that, take pictures. Make sure you have pictures on your own. Some companies may say, oh, we'll take the pictures for you. Take the pictures yourself. Make sure you have these items in your phone or on your camera. That way when you arrive at your next location, you can show them, this is not what I took a picture of. This is not what we agreed to ship. My necklace or my jewelry has pink diamonds and you shipped me something with blue diamonds. And if you can hand carry it, hand carry it. When I PCS to this installation, I put a lot of my small high value stuff in a box in my trunk. Yes, it was kind of like inconveniencing trying to figure out where it was whenever I got to this installation in between packing, but it was more comforting knowing, okay, yes, I know I have it. They don't have it, I have it, and it's safe. Again, taking photos and videos. I think I took up, if you have an iPhone, I took up most of my space PCSing, taking pictures and videos of the items I had. It was easier once I got to my station to delete it. Again, it's a pain, but it helps when you get to your next station. Make sure the movers list the totes, contents, and inventory. If you say one container and then you just mark it as this one container and not what's inside of that container, it's a lot easier for things inside of that container to go missing. Make sure you're listing everything that's inside of that container before you just let them like tape it up and just say one box. Take your time and make sure your inventory is accurate and complete before you sign it. If you see any errors, correct them before you sign. I don't think I had that many items when I moved. And I believe it took almost 9 hours to go through the little amount that I had in detail. And we went over it and over it and over it. If I felt like something wasn't, if their writing wasn't clear to me, I asked someone else to rewrite it. And it wasn't to be rude. It was more so I didn't want my TVs and things like that to go missing. High risk, high value inventory. May include but not limited to currency, coins, jewelry, silverware, crystal, figurines, furs, objects of art, software programs, manuscripts, comic books, baseball cards, stamps, and other collectible items that have a value in excess of $100 per pound. I will say if it's important to you, then it's important to you. If it's important to you, make sure that you are taking care of those items and properly documenting those items. Because if it's transported and you did not properly document it, once you get to your next installation, it's going to be a lot harder for us to ensure that everything was taken care of in the process of your move. You and the TSP must open all containers on inventory, on HR and HD inventory, and physically inspect before signing the air inventory. So from start to finish, it's a process between you and the movers. You are making sure that the movers are moving and transporting your items correctly, and you are making sure that when it gets there, because it's 9 times out of 10 is going to be different movers, right? So you want to make sure that in the process nothing went missing. This is delivery day. I hope it's not delivery day for you, but it looks like that bottom photo. I have heard of some horror stories. I haven't seen any personally, but it can be a bit hectic, and we understand that, we know that, so just make sure you're paying attention. TSP use either an 1850 or a form 1840. These forms can be found with the movers when they give it to you. Fill out the back if you discover additional damage after they leave. So when the movers are there with you, they will have this form for you to fill out for things that have arrived, damaged or missing. And on the back, you can take the time when you're maybe more relaxed and go through and say, hey, maybe I didn't notice this while you were here because we were kind of in a rush to get you out of the house so I can go maybe run an errand. But now that I'm looking, this glass is broken. Things like that. filling out the notice of loss or damage after delivery. Again, go through these forms. If you're having any trouble with filling out these forms, you can call the Claim Service Center at RightPat. You can go on their website online. You can call the legal office and we can help you. But ultimately, going to www.move.mil to start the process is where you want to go. An important thing to remember, you need to fill out the forms 1840 and 1850 within 75 days from the delivery date. TSP must be notified of all loss or damage within 75 days. So you have 75 days. Maybe you're running a lot of errands and you need them out and you need all those days to run those errands, but you have 75 days to go through and let them know what may be missing or damaged. So this is a foot stomper. Hit submit. I'm not sure what exactly happened or why people aren't hitting submit on the website, but make sure you go online and hit submit after each section that you go through. So for the 75 days, we're allowing you 75 days to let the movers know, hey, something's not right. It seems like a lot of time right now, but when you're in the process of moving, it's not. Because you're overwhelmed, you're at a new station, and you have a lot going on, and we understand that. Take your 75 days, take your time. And then you have 9 months, within 9 months of delivery, to notify that your claim has been filed. You must hit the submit button in order to do that. You have 9 months to do that. Again, doesn't seem like a lot of time, but we've noticed that when people get to their installations, they may be told, hey, welcome to the installation. You have a month to get everything in order and you're gonna deploy. Especially being here at Fairchild, this is a high tempo deployment base. There's a lot of bases like that where you've got a little amount of time to get your stuff together and then you leave. We understand that. You get 9 months, within 9 months of the delivery, to notify that your claim has been filed. Make sure you hit submit. They have the option, the movers have the option to repair the item if repairable, replace the item with new or comparable item, pay you in cash to repair or replace the item. And again, at the bottom, 75 days just to notify them, just to say, hey, here is the issue. And then you have 9 months to file the claim. Again, while it may seem like a lot of time, we have no idea what we're going to be going through once we PCS. So while it seems like a lot of time now, it may seem like a lifesaver once you realize what you've got yourself into at your new PCS. Defense Personal Property System, DPS, you still must notify within 70 days and still must file the claim within 9 months, but this is ultimately the website and what it looks like. For non-DPS FRV, for placement value claims, you can go on this website and register. Again, if you have any questions about how to navigate through this website or something doesn't seem clear, call your local legal office or call the Claim Service Center. DPS FRV claims. If you can't settle on certain items, you can file those unresolved items with the Claim Service Center. And at the bottom, you'll see the number. If you have any issues about running through it, your best bet is to talk to them at DSN 986-8044 or 1-877-754-1212. I call both numbers, and each time a human has answered. So they're really nice, and they can help you maneuver through the claims process. Total loss of claims on the FRV. That photo shows like what may be considered like your doomsday. I'm not really sure what's going on there. But TSP's liability on the FRV is limited to the greater of either $5,000 per shipment or $4 per net weight of shipment up to $50,000. Call the Claim Service Center if the amount is greater than or near the limit. Again, you have 9 months from the date of delivery to file your claim at DPS to get full replacement value. However, you see there at the bottom, you can file the claim at the Claim Service Center within 2 years of delivery, but you won't get full replacement value. The 2-year statute of limitations is not waiverable. At this point, if you waited the 9 months and you say, okay, I've missed the full replacement value, and you get to 2 years, I'm not sure when you planned on filing it after 2 years, but it's not waiverable, just so you know. If you get to that 2 year mark and you're like, oh, I'm gonna wait till my third year. Make sure to get to obtain full replacement value, 9 months, and a depreciated value, 2 years is your limit. Filing your claim with the Air Force, you can go to claims.jag.af.mil. If you have any questions about maneuvering through this site or anything about it, contact your local legal office or contact the Claims Service Center. POB damage claims is a different process than for filing household goods damage. Follow the TMO guidance. Contact your local TMO about POV drop-off, and make sure when you're picking it up at a port to thoroughly inspect. There was a person who almost didn't thoroughly inspect theirs, and they came by the legal office and they filed their claim. Everything was fine, but they said they were kind of tired and they wanted to go home, and something told them to wait a minute, and when they opened up their vehicle, a rat had chewed through a lot of their seat coverings and things like that. It had just chewed through their seat and chewed up some wires within their car. And if they would not have taken the time to look at that, they would have never noticed it, and it would have been on them to have that replaced. So make sure you're paying attention and inspecting your vehicle properly. Any and all damage on the reverse side of the form 788. I've been told that sometimes when you are picking up your vehicle from certain ports, sometimes they rush you. Do not let them rush you. And if you feel like they're rushing you, feel free to report them. But do not let them rush you. Make sure you're taking your time to fill those forms out. And you have 30 days to report any damage you've noticed at the base legal office or the Claims Service Center. It says contact your base legal to inspect your POV. That is not for you specifically. I've actually talked to them about that, and the reason why they have that there is because the Claims Service Center reaches out to us in case the pictures you have provided does not come out clear. So you can contact us to see if your photos are clear, but we do not come out and inspect and take photos of your vehicle for you. Be wary of accepting any payment from the Vehicle Processing Center. Once you accept that payment, that's final, right? You've accepted the payment, it's final, it's your settlement at that point. If you feel like, if you find out later it's not enough, it's kind of too late for that, so make sure you're paying attention, and like it says at the top, being wary of accepting any payment from the Vehicle Processing Center. So these are top 10 reasons your claim could be negatively impacted. I will say I've kind of went over a lot of the main ones throughout this already. Make sure that you're paying attention to those small items such as jewelry, making sure you are looking at what is actually on the inventory, not filing, you're missing bed, not noticing, letting them, not providing them notice of your missing bed within 75 days after delivery, not using DPS, things like that. So make sure that you're listing the damages on your Ferrari before you leave the port. Do not leave the port and your Ferrari's all messed up and decide later on that, oh no, it's missing a bumper. Please pay attention and make sure these things are being filed. We are your advocate. Those are some of the personnel that were in the office. I'm not sure if they're still there, but they're really nice people. If you still use snail mail, they answer their mail at the bottom. AFCSC/JA1940 Albrook Avenue, Suite 500, and that's Wright-Patt Air Force Base. There's people there, they're very nice, and this is their job all day long. So please feel free to reach out to them, email them, call them. Thank you for attending our Smooth Move briefing.
Hi, I'm Julie Bergman with the Transition Assistance Program. We're here to help you move on to your next adventure in life. Next slide, please. The transition program has changed predominantly. In October of 2019, the rules have changed so that now we have four different aspects that you have to complete of the transition program. The first one is initial counseling. It is mandated that you do initial counseling 365 days prior to your separation or retirement date. So please plan ahead. We do encourage you to come and see us 2 years for retirees and 18 months early for separatees. So please plan ahead. Initial counseling and pre-separation counseling are the first two elements, and both of those elements need to be completed within 365 days of your date of separation. There's of course certain situations that negate that from happening, but most of the time we try to hit 365 days prior to separation. The transition class is a week-long class. There are some exceptions and waivers to taking the last 3 days of the class, but they are very rare. So please let us know when you can come to transition class and be available for the entire week. Try not to have any appointments during that week. The last piece of that is the capstone. So once you finish your initial counseling, your pre-separation counseling, TAP class, you will have to do a capstone appointment, which is basically sitting down with us and doing another overview to make sure that you have all the resources you need, all your I's are dotted, T's are crossed, that kind of thing. So this is the new program is very beneficial to you. So we start out with an initial counseling class or initial counseling session where we sit down with you, we talk through your plan, we get you resources up front. Then you start your precep, your TAP class, and then we follow up at the end of it with a capstone to make sure everything is done. The end goal that you need to have accomplished is a final 2648 that has been signed by your command. You need it red stamped before you can final out the base. There are additional resources as well. Next page, please. We have four additional workshops. One is a employment workshop where we learn things about resume writing, how to set up your LinkedIn profile, how to interview. We do mock interviews, that kind of thing. So it's a very helpful workshop. We have a vocational training track. That one is a very good class because it can help you explore different career fields. So they do interest inventories, explore different career fields, figure out where you would find the most fulfilling work, and figure out how you can make money at that. We have manage your education. So if you're looking at going back to school using your post 9/11 GI Bill or Montgomery GI Bill or some other form of education benefits, Barry Miller at the education office teaches a very informative class on that. We also have the boots to business class. So if you're an entrepreneur looking to start your own business, that can be very beneficial as well. The Small Business Association comes in and teaches the class. And they're extremely helpful. They talk about licensure, LLCs, how to set up a business plan, anything that you need to get yourself launched in the business arena. Right now with COVID-19, things are being done a little bit differently. So we have an online TAP curriculum that you're welcome to go through if you would like to, or if you have time, we would like to schedule you for later TAP classes and later modules. We are currently doing initial counseling one-on-one in person, and then we're doing a virtual precep if need be. So please give us a call, let us know what your situation is. You can reach us at 247-2246. And as soon as we get back up and running and are able to hold classes again, we have a Meet the Employers event on the last day of TAP class. So on the Friday of TAP class, you don't have to be in TAP class to attend. So we highly recommend that you do attend either way. But we have a panel of human resources representatives from the community that come in and talk to you about what the expectations are. What are some of the things that they see people do in interviews that maybe they shouldn't? What do they see on people's resumes that maybe shouldn't be there? Or tips to be successful, how to submit your resume, how to work through the online process, how to get in the front door. So it's a great opportunity. As soon as we're back up and running, we're going to have Meet the Employer events again. And I highly encourage you, if you're transitioning, come and talk to HR professionals and see what they have to say about the civilian workforce right now. Even if you're not interested in working for the companies that we have on the panel that week, It still doesn't hurt to come in, try out your elevator speech, have them look at your resume, things like that, and just practice. If you have any questions, concerns, please give us a call, 247-2246. Myself, Mr. Kingan, and Mr. Leroy Olson are more than happy to help you through your process.
Hi, my name is Erica Karen. I'm the Casualty Assistance Representative and Survivor Benefits Counselor for Fairchild Air Force Base. Today I'm here to talk to you guys about moving as well as inbound processes. A lot of times when we move or we are inbound to a new location, we have this huge checklist of things that we have to do, such as schools, housing, healthcare. But one of the things that's often missed is your VRED, or your record of emergency data. So in order to update this, all you need to do is a simple process. Just go on the Air Force portal, go to virtual MPF, then VRED, update all your personal information, your addresses, your phone numbers, as well as anybody else that is on there, maybe your parents or a relative that you may have put on there a long time ago that may have moved. So on there, another thing that you can update is your PAD. Your PAD is your person authorized to direct disposition of human remains. What that means is that in your unfortunate, if you were to pass away, that is the person that mortuary affairs or myself as a casualty officer would address any kind of funeral arrangements or anything like that. A lot of times spouses think that they are the PAD just because they are the primary next of kin. This is incorrect. The person that is the PAD is the person that is designated on the VRED. That is the only person that we will speak with. So while you're in there and you're updating all your addresses and such, make sure that you go in there and include your PAD. Virtual part of your military personnel file provides sole source of contact information for the primary next of kin and other persons to notify in case of injury, death, or emergency. It serves as an official document required by law for designated beneficiaries for a death gratuity as well. It does not just designate on there who we contact in case of an emergency. Your death gratuity beneficiary is also on there, as well as we just spoke of your PAD. The next system that I wanted to talk to you guys about updating is called your SOES, your Service Members Online Enrollment System. This is a relatively new enrollment system because it used to be that when you did your SGLI, it was a paper form that you completed and then submitted that way. Now, SOES is all online. It is available 24/7. And so if you have a CAT card and you have access to your military computer, you can update this at any time of the day at your own leisure. What can service members do in SOES? Service members may increase, reduce, or cancel SGLI, which is your service members group life insurance, and your FSGLI, which is your family service members group life insurance coverage. You can add a beneficiary, you can edit SGLI beneficiary information, and you can view, save, or print an SGLI coverage certificate. As I mentioned before, this is all available at your own leisure with availability of a CAT card. All you do is you go into Mil Connect, you sign in at the top right-hand corner, and then on the drop-down boxes, you choose your SOES, S-O-E-S, and then you can do any of these changes any time of day. This is a really important conversation that you should have with your spouse whenever you're moving, because as your life changes, so do your life insurance needs. Maybe you just got married and you decided that you wanted to lower your FSGLI, or maybe your SGLI was previously designated to your parents, and now that you had a new baby or now that you've been remarried, you need to update that information. I always like to tell my members that when they move or when you're inbound or outbound to a new station, this is a perfect time to do this because you have that checklist, you're going through your processes, so this is a good time to do it. SOES can be found on the DoD Mil Connect portal. Casualty Assistance Office is here to help you anytime. My phone number is 247-4488. If you have any questions on SOES, on your VRED, or on anything else that may be associated with casualty, or if you have maybe a new spouse that just came into the military and you just got married and maybe doesn't know as much about your SGLI or may have questions, call me. Call me anytime. I am located at 7 West Arnold Street in Suite 35, as most people know it as the ID card building. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Nancy Keaton. I'm the Community Child Care Coordinator here at Fairchild. I'd like to give you some information on making your move easier and some available child care resources and programs that are available to you. Our first opportunity that I'd like to tell you about is our free PCS care. You are eligible to receive 20 hours of free child care when you're getting ready to move. Basically, this is paid by Air Force Aid Society. You take your orders and go to Airmen and Family Readiness Center, and there they give you a voucher. Then please call me, again, Nancy Keaton at the FCC office, and I'll give you names and numbers of FCC providers who can take care of your children and offer great services. It really is helpful when you get ready to move just to have a little additional time, and your children love being with the FCC providers. They have so many fun games and activities for them to do, and it is completely free. So I hope you take care of this opportunity, this free PCS child care. The next thing, before you leave, I recommend going to militarychildcare.com and registering your children either at the school age program or their youth center, so that once you arrive at the next base, then you're already in the system, they know you're coming, and they're able to reserve a spot for you as well. Also, I recommend calling the Family Child Care office. There, the community child care coordinator can tell you about the different child care availability and resources that are at the base you're arriving at. Also, call the CDC and school age program if you're interested in getting more detailed information. Some other resources that are available to you that are great information is contacting your school liaison. That person will be able to tell you about the school that your child will be going to and some benefits and additional resources that might be helpful for you. Also, if you have an EFMP child, contact your EFMP specialist. She can get you set up with the respite care program, getting a respite care provider, and setting you up with that free program as well, and also great resources that they have available. Please contact your family child care coordinator at that office, and they can just tell you, give you information about child care programs, resources, and referrals that you might need. Hope you have a great move. Thanks for being at Fairchild.
Welcome to the Exceptional Family Member Program orientation. This orientation was designed for you, Air Force families newly enrolled into the Exceptional Family Member Program. You spoke and we listened during recent EFMP continuous process improvement events, and one of the results was this EFMP orientation. Using constructive feedback from families currently enrolled in EFMP, we developed the curriculum to be engaging and full of useful tools to guide you and your family as you matriculate into the Exceptional Family Member Program. This orientation is presented as a collaborative partnership between agencies represented under the EFMP Medical, EFMP Assignments, and EFMP Family Support umbrellas. Collectively, our purpose is to provide you a clear understanding of the Exceptional Family Member Program, its available support services, and how to navigate across medical, educational diagnoses and treatment, assignments coordination, and family support for optimal results that best benefit your career progression and your family members' medical and special education needs. The Exceptional Family Member Program enjoys high visibility, and its service delivery and resources are under continuous review at all levels within the Air Force. As part of today's orientation, you will learn Air Staff's role in EFMP, how the EFMP business process owners work together, current and future Air Force initiatives that support families with special needs, and resources available to your family members. Several years ago, the Air Force decided it would be beneficial to tag one organization to be the overall Air Force point of contact for the Exceptional Family Member Program. Air Force Directive 3682 designates Air Force Services Directorate as that single point of contact for all three EFMP component agencies, medical, assignments, and family support. As the Air Force POC for EFMP, the Services Directorate, or A1S, coordinates review of policy updates and program changes to ensure consistent service delivery. Additionally, A1S advocates for resources and promotes the Exceptional Family Member Program as a whole. A1S also happens to be the lead agency for EFMP Family Support, developing, writing, and reviewing EFMP Family Support policy as required. EFMP Medical, EFMP Assignments, and EFMP Family Support form a triad of agencies that work collaboratively to deliver a coordinated system of care and support to Air Force families with exceptional needs. These agencies each have a different role in EFMP and offer different services to support families. EFMP Medical screens and enrolls family members into the program and ensures medical and educational services are available at Airman's current and gaining location by a process known as Facility Determination Inquiry. EFMP Assignments coordinates consideration to assign personnel against valid manning requirements at locations where suitable general medical services, special education, early intervention, or related services are available to exceptional family members. EFMP Family Support provides coordination of family support services on and off installations through family needs assessments and also serves as a referral service for local, state, and federal resources. Throughout this orientation, you will hear from EFMP Medical, Assignments, and Family Support representatives who will provide you with an overview of their respective areas and tools to use their services and resources to get the response you need. The Exceptional Family Member Program is highly regulated with public law, Department of Defense instructions, and Air Force instructions. On this slide, we have highlighted foundational public law and our most recent guidance. Together, they provide a good overview of how EFMP is executed by the Department of Defense and the Air Force. EFMP Medical, Assignments, and Family Support have specific guidance to follow. The representatives from these agencies that you will meet today will provide you with additional details. For the past 3 years, the Air Force has executed significant events that enhanced EFMP for families. Starting in 2016, as a result of the Secretary of the Air Force Spouse and Family Forum, EFMP respite care hours were increased from 12 to 40 hours per month, and quarterly EFMP family member webcasts were implemented to foster communication between families and EFMP subject matter experts. In 2017 and 2018, the three EFMP partner agencies worked together to host EFMP events, which generated initiatives that are currently underway. For example, we educated families on pre-screening capabilities, such as TRICARE Online, so airmen could make better career and family planning decisions. And EFMP Assignments established a Facebook page, which has become instrumental in keeping families aware of program changes and has been a useful communication channel for EFMP providers to respond to questions. Through rapid improvement event efforts, we formalized training for EFMP family support coordinators to establish a standard level of proficiency across all installations. Manning for EFMP was increased with 61 positions added to support families. With the success of the RIE, which was directed by the Vice Chief of Staff of the Air Force, another EFMP event was planned for 2018. EFMP Summit 2018 was held in San Antonio, and it built upon issues identified during the previous RIE. The EFMP orientation was an idea or concept that was an action item from the 2017 RIE, and the summit was an opportunity to solicit feedback from EFMP families in developing the curriculum. So, here we are today executing this care solution for families with special needs. EFMP Summit participants also identified a lack of support activities for adult exceptional family members. We listened, and in FY19, more resources were approved to develop EFMP camps and activities for adults and caregivers. The DD-3054 Family Needs Assessment Form was published in April 2019, and EFMP Family Support was added to the virtual out-processing checklist to ensure EFMP families complete this form and ensure a warm handoff between installations. Your EFMP Family Support Coordinator will provide more information on how this form is used. An Air Force working group composed of EFMP subject matter experts meets each month, and discussions are underway to address the Joint Base concerns where Air Force EFMP families reside on installations not led by the Air Force. More than 15 initiatives were identified in the past 2 years. 9 have either been resolved or have made significant progress. We will continue to solicit feedback and comments from families to enhance the program. Let us know at the end of this orientation if it was beneficial and how we can make it more worthwhile for you. Military OneSource is a great resource for families. It is a Department of Defense funded program that's both a 24/7, 365 call center and a website that seeks to meet the holistic needs of service members and their families, giving them the tools and resources they need to thrive. The call center and website offer support for a wide range of topics for families with special needs. Military OneSource is a virtual extension of military support programs and is ideal for military families who do not live near military installations or who need schedule flexibility. The call center is staffed by master's degree level consultants with an education in a social science field like psychology or marriage and family therapy. Because there are no automated phone menus or voice recordings, military families can quickly find the support they need in the format that's best for them. EFMP Results Outreach Consultants are located at the call centers and are able to assist EFMP families with a myriad of topics relating to special education, guardianship, support groups, legal assistance, and many others. All contacts to Military OneSource are confidential, with the exception of situations where there is harm to self or others, to include mandated reporting for child abuse and domestic violence. Military OneSource connects service members and their families to the most appropriate resources, whether they are provided through Military OneSource or installation and community-based programs. All active duty, National Guard, and Reserve members, regardless of activation status, their immediate families, surviving spouses, and their children are eligible for Military OneSource services. Veterans and their immediate families are eligible for Military OneSource up to 365 days after separation or retirement. There are many resources available at the local, state, and federal level to assist families with special needs. Your EFMP Family Support Coordinator will identify many of these in his or her brief and provide additional information. Please pay special attention to the direct step and special ed connections, which could be extremely beneficial. They are self-paced study courses and are available at no cost to you. Also, the systematic training of military parents, or STOMP, can assist with EFMP processes and available resources through state and federal agencies. There is much to learn, but your EFMP team, medical, assignments, and family support is here to help and ensure you and your family members are ready and resilient throughout your military career and beyond. So get ready, listen closely, and let's navigate through the Exceptional Family Member Program.
Welcome, Team Fairchild. I'm Second Lieutenant Hillary Fong. Today I will be briefing you on TRICARE, how it relates to you when you have a permanent change of station. So this is what we'll be talking about today. What is TRICARE? How do you plan on your move? Getting care with while you're traveling, and your benefit at your new location.